So this morning I'm talking to Sally Okun, who's the Vice President of Advocacy, Policy, and Public Safety at Patients Like Me here in Cambridge. Sally, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today.
Thank you for having me, Mark. I really appreciate the chance to talk with you.
So we've talked before, and I'm always fascinated by the story of how Patients Like Me came to be. So would you tell us that story?
Sure, absolutely. You know, it's not uncommon at all for a one patient or a one family story to actually be a driver behind innovation, whether it's in healthcare or some other experience. And for our company, it was very much that. So Stephen Haywood, who was 29 at the time he was diagnosed with ALS, had two brothers, Jamie and Ben Haywood, and a good friend, Jeff Cole, who at the time of Stephen's diagnosis decided to dive in deeply and figure out how they might help to stall the progression of his disease, or in fact, try to cure his disease. Jeff, all of them coming out of MIT, engineer-minded and solution-oriented, so they really wanted to find some ways of being able to help Stephen through this. What they found was rather frustrating. A lot of the research wasn't available for them to be able to get at. Some of the information that they were receiving was conflicting. And they ultimately decided that much of what they were actually learning was from other patients and families who were dealing with the same issues, and decided that they really needed to find a way of being able to bring those patients and families together to better learn and connect with each other, and ultimately find ways of being able to monitor and track their own experiences. Bringing that together, you start to learn about the collective experience and the collective wisdom of everyone else. So Patients Like Me was actually born out of that kind of model, is bringing people together, helping them find different ways of being able to problem solve in their own times of living with illness, but also finding ways of being able to connect to the opportunities to contribute to research, and that was a big component of what we do.
Well, there's a wonderful story about the ALS community on Patients Like Me contributing to research around a report out of Italy, I think it was, that maybe lithium would benefit these patients. Can you tell us about that?
Sure, you're exactly right. It was a small Italian study that was done, and it indicated, or it claimed actually, that the use of lithium carbonate was actually slowing the progression of ALS in a small subset of patients. What our patients on the site, who are already part of a community that was tracking and monitoring their condition, many of them went to their doctors and said, you know, I want to try lithium. And in this particular population, the doctors oftentimes will work with their patients to try to determine an appropriate use for an off-label indication. So in this case, many of the patients started using lithium. In fact, we had about 348 patients on the site who were actually taking lithium under their clinician's review and starting to track their experience with that. And they came to us very activated to say, can you help us start to gather the data in such a way that we can actually start to determine whether or not this claim from this study is right or wrong? What we learned in a very short period of time, right, frankly, in 9 months, we were able to demonstrate with this group of patients that the claims that were made in the initial study were not holding up, that the progression was continuing. There was no indication that the progression was slowing as a result of using the product. And so we took that opportunity to suggest that this was an environment within which patients who are activated and interested in participating in research could contribute their data in a very meaningful way. We took it to the next step, however, because we understood that we have a biased population. So our research scientists and data scientists spent time developing a novel algorithm where they could match patients who were using lithium with patients who actually had a similar disease course but were not on lithium. So they were able to create a control group that actually then was useful in being able to support the report that we ultimately showed, which was that lithium really did not have an impact on the progression of ALS. And in fact, you know, for some patients it could have been a concern because they were actually taking a drug that might have had adverse effects that they didn't necessarily need to incur. So it was a great opportunity to show the power of a patient research network.
So you began with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, but you've certainly expanded well beyond that. Can you tell us about the other conditions, or the number of conditions and the number of communities that are now on Patients Like Me?
Sure. We currently have about 270,000 patients on the site. We cover over 2,000 different conditions. Initially, when we came out of the first few years with Patients Like Me, we were really relatively small communities that were focusing a lot on these very serious neurological conditions, similar similar to ALS with MS and that sort of thing. And since then, we've really expanded quite a bit. So today we have communities that are focused on multiple sclerosis is one of our largest communities still, about 40,000 patients. We have a very large community of fibromyalgia patients, patients for whom the system isn't necessarily very helpful because it's such a complex condition with a lot of symptoms and not a treatment in sight right now. Many mood conditions, so we have a lot of patients who are using the site for monitoring their depression or their anxiety disorders. But then other conditions such as epilepsy, rheumatoid arthritis, many of those are also in the thousands of patients. We're seeing more and more some of the more rare conditions and oftentimes parents coming onto the sites to start to monitor and track their children who have some unusual and rare conditions as well. So it's really expanded just exponentially, frankly, from where we began, and it's very exciting to have the opportunity to have so many different conditions represented.
Well, this is a health informatics course, mm-hmm. and I know from discussions we've had in the past that there is a lot of informatics sitting under this beautiful user-friendly, non-technical site. Can you tell us a bit about what it takes to actually make this thing work?
Sure. It does take a lot of engineering. Much of our company, we have about 80 staff now, much of our company are engineers, software developers, designers, user experience specialists. Then we also have the other side of the house, which is research scientists, data scientists, and clinicians who are trying to bring the two worlds together in very much in a health IT perspective. So on the clinical side, for example, we actually take all of the data that comes in from patients, and we actually code that against the standardized terminologies that you would find in an electronic health record, for
example. Can you tell us which ones?
Sure, we actually code against most of the ones that you would imagine. So ICD, SNOMED, we use MEDRA for side effect data, which is what the pharmaceutical industry as well as the FDA uses for monitoring adverse events. We use Multum database right now for our drug database, but we're moving more towards using RxNorm. Again, another one of the standardized terminologies that's within the UMLS library. So we try very much to use existing standardized databases in order to be able to normalize our data in some way so that it ultimately could be able to be interoperable with other systems. Right now, that's not as transparent on the site as you might imagine, but when you go behind the scenes, we can then begin to look at how many ways have people talked about their symptom against a particular specific clinical concept. And there could be 30 different ways that patients actually express one clinical concept. So that's actually contributing to the development of a patient vocabulary that actually maps back to clinical concepts. And there's probably close to 8,000 or 9,000 terms in there now that are in patients' voice that we've actually then mapped to clinical concepts.
Super. I know you've recently, we talked earlier about clinical research, and you emphasized that the lithium study really isn't a controlled trial in the classic sense,
mm-hmm.
but you guys are helping your users, your patients, find and get involved in clinical trials, I understand. Can you tell us about that?
I can, and we have a few ways of doing that. One is that we download every night the data from clinicaltrials.gov, and so a patient can look at their profile the next morning and see, based on their profile data, which trials they actually matched against within 25 miles of their home. Gives them a place to begin. Then we've also just recently announced a service that we're going to be providing to the pharmaceutical industry. It's called Trial Access. We've learned from our patients through surveys that we've done with them that many of them have been invited to participate in trials, and many of them have not been satisfied with the experience of those who actually did participate. Sometimes it's because there wasn't enough patient-oriented consideration into what it took to participate in a trial. So what we've learned is that by having this service called Trial Access, we're actually going to be helping patients participate in the development of trials right from the very start. So they're better able to say, this particular intervention is going to be very inconvenient for me to be able to do. Had you considered that? Now, another way of being able to state that could be, if I'm going to have a blood sample drawn, we need to determine how far away I'm going to need to go to get that, or can someone come to my home and do that? So there's different ways that patients can actually contribute practical advice to the trial development
process. So patient-centered clinical trials.
Absolutely.
A new concept.
All the way through the system. And actually even also to the point where they're participating in the evaluation of that trial. How did it go? And being able to get some findings back to them. Right now, you participate in a clinical trial and you never know what the outcomes of that trial were. And if you have access to a journal, you might be able to find the publication at some point, but much of that data isn't published. What we're saying and we're suggesting and we're hoping that the industry really begins to embrace, patients need to have some feedback. There needs to be a mechanism that if I've contributed my data and I'm participating in this study, I'd like to have some sense of how it all went and how it did contribute to new knowledge. So.
Well, great. Well, so that sort of leads to my last question, uh-huh. which is I'm going to ask you to get out your crystal ball and what do you see as the future of patients like me, at least that you can discuss? And specifically, and I'm not sure I know the answer to this one, so I'll be interested. How do you see patients like me being involved in VDT, the move for patients to be able to upload their electronic records and share their data with each other and with other clinicians?
Well, we have a lot of exciting things going on, and some of the projects that we're currently working on are very much about that. We're doing some testing and piloting of sensors and mobile devices and wearables, trying to figure out ways of being able to give patients the opportunity to have access to these devices, bringing that data into our platform, and then ultimately finding a way of bringing that data into the clinical record so it can be useful. But there's a lot that you, as you might imagine, that goes along with that. We need to think about how do we standardize that data, how do we understand how to code that data. So we're just really beginning to learn. And those projects are just launched. We've just actually sent out the packages to the patient participants so they can start to do that active data collection. You know, we see the platform as being an environment where patients can truly be a part of the changing healthcare system in an area where we've never really had access to their voice in such a systematic way before. And we believe that actually that contribution will really help us achieve the promise of a continuously learning health system. Without that voice, we're sort of operating in a bit of a vacuum. So we are continuing to build the platform with that in mind. We hope within the next year or so to really have the ability to have that interoperability data exchange so that we might be able to pull in data from an EHR record to unburden the patient from having to enter all that data in. But you know, there's another facet to that. The patient can also verify the data.
Exactly.
You know, and really reconcile the medication list, for example, as part of the helping to then achieve something that an electronic health record holder needs to do. They need to reconcile the medication record, and this is a way of being able to do that. So there's a variety of ways that we see our ability to be able to take advantage of that kind of view, download, and transmit type of technology, but we want it to be bi-directional. Let's get data going back and forth so that ultimately each record is a reflection of the full 360 view of the patient.
You know, you raise a really interesting point. I was at a talk recently from someone from the Geisinger Clinic, which uh-huh. is a very well-known health system in Pennsylvania, and they have an open chart initiative which allows patients to see their actual charts. And one of the benefits they've seen is that patients find and help them correct mistakes.
Errors, exactly. Sure. You know, it's really very common for something to be on a record that isn't quite accurate, or for a patient to see a medication that they may have taken 10 years ago, but no longer take, and be able to say to the doctor, you know, this is not accurate, let's fix it together. You know, one of the things that I've been playing around with is this equation, and I've been talking about it a lot lately, and that's this notion of shared data. So my data as a patient, your data as a clinician, our data together actually can, when you add that into a shared decision-making model, ultimately leads to a shared accountability for the outcomes, so that we actually all have the opportunity to share in the ways that I can improve my health, I can have my health be more reflective of what matters to me. But at the same time, I'm understanding the kinds of things that a clinician needs to know in order to be able to take better care of the needs that I have. So.
Well, as soon as I get back to Atlanta, I'm going to encourage our friend Marla to sign up. So if you see a woman with a lot of problems named Marla sign up, you should know that I sent her to you.
Well, the other thing to keep in mind, with that in mind, is that the site has levels of privacy that allow a patient to use a username or their real name. But I would want to be sure that people do know that we do take great strides to be sure that the experience for patients is safe, they can trust the site, they can feel comfortable about being able to exchange information. So.
Students know who Marla is. You don't.
I don't.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great talking to you.